I'm Brad Connor, the music director here at First Parish. Please rise in body or spirit to sing our opening hymn, page 358, Rank by Rank Again We Stand.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you. So my name is Sarah Dorr, and I am president of the parish board this year. On behalf of the parish board and the entire congregation of First Parish, we would like to welcome all of you, Jamie's family, honored guests, and fellow parishioners here today, whether you are here in person or on Zoom, for this joyous occasion. Today marks another rite of passage for First Parish as we install the Reverend Jamie Hinson-Rieger as our next senior minister and affirm our shared ministry together. Over the years, we've been blessed to have had so many dedicated and talented UU ministers to call our own. We are very, very fortunate. Please join us after the service for refreshments in our common room, which will be through these doors, or upstairs. You could go down the stairway that way. Just follow the crowd. And finally, I would be remiss if I didn't just inform everyone of the emergency exits in case of an emergency. So we have the doors in the front, or the narthex. They would take you right outside there, and then we use this door here to the left, and it would take you again outside the Elm Street door. This door here is a door, but it's not an emergency exit. So those are my words for the moment. Thank you all, and let's get the celebration going. Annie.
These words come from Sherry Woodbury. Here we are in our circle again, a circle of vision and reflection, a forum for deciding and empowering. Here we are at the base of another bridge, another space spanning the shores of today and tomorrow, beckoning us to cross the chasm one day at a time. Here we are gathered at the cusp of the future, at the boundary that holds community together. We are here in a circle of love and trust, brought to this moment by a series of choices and promises, by hope and gratitude, by our own shadows faced and befriended. Somewhere out there, all we dream is possible. Somewhere in here, we are sowing the seeds. Come, let us worship together. I invite you to rise in body or in spirit and join us in First Parish Bedford's unison affirmation that is printed in your order of worship. Just checking. Yes, and it's also in Spanish. This was a tradition we began when we had a guest living in sanctuary, and that was her primary language. So please join me in both English and in Spanish. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. El amor es el espíritu de esta iglesia, y el servicio es su ley. Este es nuestro gran pacto, vivir juntos en paz, buscar la verdad en espíritu de amor, y ayudarnos los unos a los otros.
Good afternoon. I am Evan Carvel-Zemer, the developmental lead of the New England region of your Unitarian Universalist Association and primary contact for this congregation. I bring greetings and celebrations from your sibling congregations from the far north woods of Maine to the Connecticut shores of Long Island Sound and from Lake Champlain to the tip of Cape Cod. We witness the commitments to shared ministry you are making today with Reverend Jamie. And I want to remind you to reach out to your UUA staff, to your sibling congregations, when you need assistance, when you seek company, when you have a joy to share. The fabric of our faith is made stronger by your presence among us, and the ministry this congregation shares is a blessing not only for all of you, but also for all of us. It is an honor to be here with you today.
Good afternoon. Before I introduce myself and go forward with this greeting, I want to teach you all some parts so you can be involved with this greeting. As UU Mass Action, we work in community and organize congregations. So when I point over here, if this side of the room could sing, UU Mass Action.
UU Mass Action.
And then if I point over here, I would like this side of the room to chant with vigor, justice, 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 four times.
Justice, 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 justice.
Oh, excellent. And then at the end, if you, when you're singing UU Mass Action, if you hold that note, UU Mass Action, and then if you could with the utmost vigor sing.
Justice, 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 justice.
Beautiful. So now I can begin. I am the Reverend Joe Murphy, Executive Director at
UU Mass Action.
I believe and work for
justice, 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 justice.
I wanted to welcome everyone here today, as today marks also a special day that this congregation is now an official partner congregation of
UU Mass Action.
And to welcome Reverend Jamie as he journeys with us in faith and ministry in the pursuit of
justice, 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 justice.
Again, a warm welcome to all from
UU Mass Action.
As we all work through a world, through organizing, ministry, and action for
justice, 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 justice.
Thank you so much from
UU Mass Action.
Hold. Beautiful, thank you.
So I'm gonna read some words to you from the Reverend Bill Schultz. You know I'm not him. If he was up here, his voice would be booming from the rafters. So this is from Bill Schultz. I am delighted to greet First Parish and Jamie on the occasion of his installation, and regret that I won't be there in person. I'm sure I'm only one of a handful of people who remember my own installation in your candlelit sanctuary the night of November 9th, 1975, almost 50 years ago. It lasted close to 2 hours. I trust Jamie's installation will be equally meaningful, but considerably shorter. So, I'm confident that his ministry will be markedly longer than my 2.5 years, though perhaps a bit less extended than John Gibbons's 31, much less Samuel Stearns's 36. First Parish is just about the best congregation anyone could ask for. And from what I know of Jamie, his gifts are beautifully suited to keep it that way. May your years together, however long they be a blessing to you both. From Bill Schultz.
Minutes. How do you measure
not the children and youth of First Parish. But I did interview the children and youth of First Parish to prepare this time for all ages. And I will admit, I took this idea from Rose Galogli, the religious educator at the Theodore Parker UU congregation in West Roxbury, when I attended their installation of their new senior minister just recently, and I really liked what their religious educator did. And as we currently are lacking one ourselves, I'm filling in. I asked our kids and youth, some who came to games club and some who came to our middle school youth group and some who I asked via text and other methods, three questions. What do you appreciate about Reverend Jamie? What do you think our congregation should do to be supportive of our new minister? And what do you think our new minister should do to be a good minister to our congregation? So they have some thoughts about this. Things they appreciate about Reverend Jamie. We got some good, solid, general feedback. He's nice, he's kind, he's fun, and these are all true and we love that. There were also some things that he provides, such as he lets us have snacks. Very positive, snacks will come up again. Also, he has accessible scissors. Okay, that's good too. Another thing that came up multiple times was his sense of humor, which is very true. He has a great sense of humor, including he is a little bit silly and makes me laugh. Also, his rapport with the youth came up. One person said he's chill with the kids, YK, which I presume means you know. Stories came up multiple times. Stories, he tells good stories. He's good with creative stories, and that is also true. And also there were some very specific pieces of positive feedback. One is that he knows what the movie Sully is. I didn't know, I had to Google it. Also he has a hero rat. I don't know about the hero rat. He's looking confused as well. Maybe did you tell a story about a hero rat? I don't know. Somehow there was a hero rat involved. That was positive. Ask him about his hero rat. Ask about the hero rat. And lastly, one kid said, he's just a good minister. And I very much agree. Now, what should we do, we the people of First Parish in Bedford? Well, there were some, again, some good general concepts. Support him, show up regularly, offer help, be welcoming, make sure he feels welcomed, right on track. One person said, also make sure we have good food, especially on Sundays, because ministers need energy. That's very true. One person said, give him enough money. That's right. That's right, fair compensation. We try really hard to do fair compensation here. That's something we're proud of, right on. One kid said, throw candy at him. Medium on how helpful that is. But another said, be helpful by being quiet when he is talking. We can all benefit from that advice. Another one that I needed some interpretation on was slay the house boots, which I think is Gen Z for just like, be really good, great, do it. And then lastly, keep him as our minister, which is definitely the plan. So now we get to the part of what should you do to be a good minister to the congregation. Snacks once again featured prominently. Make sure that snacks are plentiful and never let us have games club without snacks. I don't know that that's exactly your direct responsibility, but I'm glad that you facilitate the budgeting for snacks. Have fun, be nice, have a sense of humor, which we covered, we've got that down. This one's really great. Uphold a sense of community. And another said, I feel like it's important to make sure that everyone's included and at least respected for who they are. Absolutely. He needs to have stories, which he does. Throw candy at least once a week. So that's where the throwing candy at you came from. And I like that this kid was in on the idea of reciprocity and shared ministry, right? Like, this is a shared ministry and we can throw candy at each other. I don't know how often that's gonna happen in real life, but good for the concept. Find more youngins because we need more youth. Fair enough. Another said, make sure we don't wallow in our misery. I don't know exactly how you'll do that, but good luck. Another kid said, probably preaching, which I liked. Probably preaching. Probably. Make things more interactive, always good advice. Love the going back and forth with the UMass action, yes. And then the number one advice from children and youth about your ministry was to have us involve our pets more. Bring the animals to church, bless the animals, we love that. They were really in on the pets. So basically pets and snacks, but also shared ministry and making everyone feel welcomed, which I think is spot on. So I've really appreciated that you have made so clear, not only in your words, but also in your behavior, that you truly see yourself as a minister to the whole congregation of every age. And I can tell the kids have already internalized that. So I am really looking forward to continuing our shared ministry together with all ages of this congregation. Now I get to move on to the reading. I'm very excited about this reading because though our preacher, Evan Carvel-Zemer, chose the reading, it is a reading by an activist and healer who I quote very often, which is Adrienne Marie Brown. She's a multiracial black practitioner of pleasure activism who comes out of Detroit. And she's written books such as Emergent Strategy and Pleasure Activism. This is a poem entitled, This is the Only Moment, parentheses, Species Love Poetry. I can't stop being in the present, noticing how the past tells me what I should care about and the future tells me what I should fear. And the past tells me what we forgot and the future tells me what we must dream. But here, I breathe in, noticing the gift I too often take for granted, not knowing how many breaths I have left. I want to spend them being love. I have done so much, so many tasks, but what mattered most has been the listening to the thirsting dirt, to the spiraling wind in the wake of murmuration, to the drumbeat of ant feet moving abundance with a million hands, the sacred erotic of pollination, the orgasmic opening of mushrooms, pulling the yes for miles underground, the innocent violence of predators feeding their children, the way the wild wastes nothing, the way the cedar gives me permission to pray. I thought someone else had all the instructions, and I, stumbling and following, praying to become worthy, must admit I have been grieving and grieving all I don't know and don't trust, and grieving so deeply a world that is still breathing, anticipating failure in spite of my visions. But when I listen, the universe is reminding me I cannot be taken from her. I am never untethered from her roots, never beyond the whole, and nothing is lost, it is lived. And we are not here to win, but to experience love, and those who do not know love are missing life in spite of other accumulation. And when I listen, the universe is teaching me that control is impossible. And the season will change, and enough is a feeling that cannot be measured, and the small circle is the deepest, and I cannot teach anyone what I have not practiced, and I cannot change anyone but myself, and I will never feel free in a position of demand, and I am already free, and we all are when we realize it, we cannot be contained. And we are never I, even when we are lonely, even when we distinctly suffer, even when we distinctly succeed. We are of lineage, of collective, of era, of farmers' hands and strangers' prayers, of singers with their heads thrown back. We are always dancing with our ghosts and praying for our great-great-grandchildren. We are always the harvest. And the future is being decided. The future is being practiced. The future is being planted in this breath. And this breath. And this breath. So I breathe in, noticing the gift I too often take for granted. Not knowing how many breaths I have left, I want to spend them being love.
Being in the present with you on this day of celebration is a great honor. Always witnessing the changing seasons of love with congregations and ministers is an honor and a gift. I know this congregation had such a life-giving season of love with Reverend John. And now I have heard your stories of hope and excitement in this new season of love with Reverend Jamie. I know this season's transition wasn't always easy. And that too was a season of a different kind of love, and you get to keep Reverend Annie and the love you share with her. Such a time of celebration, it is human to think of the future, to be excited, hopeful, usually a little nervous too. And then for many of us right now, there is a lot looming in the future that makes us a little anxious, if not afraid. For our world, our country, our towns, and yes, our congregations. I can't stop being in the present, noticing how the past tells me what I should care about, and the future tells me what I should fear, and the past tells me what we forgot, and the future tells me what we must dream. So often, our past tells us we should worry about attendance numbers, about money, about if our congregation is running the best program compared to our UU neighbors. Can we let go of all of that? Let go of the measurements, let go of the worry of which congregation looks like it's doing better. Let go of the worries of future decline. Let go and dream. Let go and measure in love. Humans will always need community, will always need to make meaning of our lives, will always seek to act in collective ways to make love more real in this world. In a world of rising hate, democracy threatened, and climate change, we must dream and act and be love. And the future is being decided, the future is being practiced, the future is being planted in this breath and this breath and this breath. There is no action plan from here to there in this time. There is no 3 to 5 year strategic plan. There is no, we will work really hard now and later it will all be fine. We must be the future we dream now, decide, practice, plant. The way we are now is the future we are creating. And whether we liked it or not, and mostly we haven't, the COVID-19 pandemic pushed us from the world still pretending strategic plans worked to this world where we are tired of hearing the word liminal, where there are no experts and we are all stumbling and following and praying someone else has the instructions. Through COVID, we learned where we are good at flexibility and adaptation and where we are not. Where we are good at feeling and grieving what is lost, and where we are not. Where we are good at meeting our community's needs, and where we are not. Where we are good at resting when we need, and where we are not. Where we noticed our community and our own joy, and yes, at new opportunities, and where we did not. The future is being decided, the future is being practiced, the future is being planted. We have been practicing the future, and there is no return to the time before. The time before was already becoming this future. As your UUA staff, I am so often asked for answers, an action plan, a checklist. There was a time I thought I could give answers, but 2014, it was so different than 2024. And can we even imagine what 2034 will be like? Now, I can only give you answers for the simplest of things. Mostly, I can offer guidance on good process, encouragement, company, questions, maybe a new way of understanding your congregation, some suggestions gleaned from other congregations. A reminder you're not alone, that you can do hard things and you have support, but I do not have answers. I actually delight in the straightforward emails. Yes, I know the answer to this one emails. Please ask me if you're a new employee, is a contractor, and if you can use a 1099 to pay them. I know the answer to that one. Now you might be wondering, all right, Reverend Ramey might have asked the wrong preacher, and there's all these people up here in their fancy clothes. Maybe one of them has the answers. No. No, they've got ideas and hope and wisdom. They've got experiments in the works, insight and prayers, but no answers. In a world of such profound change on so many different levels, each trend impacting every other level, results can no longer be predicted or planned for. So is there an expert in that? Well, you have to read the so-called experts carefully. I read a study recently showing that by the year 2100, places in Western Massachusetts like Greenfield are going to become empty because of how many people are moving to the coasts. Clearly did not take into account climate change or the exponential increase of storms on the coast. The best experts in where religious practice is heading say we are experiencing change on the level of the Protestant Reformation. You will find some answers. You and your neighboring congregations, we will find some answers together. And then when they don't work, we will find new ones. Here is what I know. We are practicing the future, and the way we are with each other now is the future we are planting. If we can be flexible and adaptive enough to meet our community's needs today, we are gaining the skills and abilities to be flexible and adaptive enough to meet tomorrow's needs and the next day's. We cannot plan the future, we can only practice the future. So today I have five not so simple or easy ways to keep being together as we practice the future. The first two are particularly challenging to the values of our Puritan past. I'm putting them first because I'm afraid if I don't, what some of you will take away is we must work harder. No. If you take nothing else from me today, please remember, Evan said the answer is not work harder. The answer is not work harder. I may not know the answers, but I do know a few things that are not the answers. First, we must learn how to rest and recharge. So many are teetering on the edge of burnout or trying to claw their way out of that pit, especially people in caregiving professions, school staff, mental health counselors, and healthcare providers. Many parents and caregivers have never had the chance to fully recover from that parent full-time while working full-time crammed into one small house experience. And the past 4 years have been very hard on the mental, emotional, physical, and spiritual lives of our religious professionals. And I know this is true for many of our volunteer lay leaders as well, especially those of you who helped with pastoral care, managed the many technology pivots, served as board presidents, committee chairs, those of you who picked up extra tasks during the interim, your search committee. We must practice a future where we rest, where we take turns, where it's okay to do less, where we prioritize caring for each other. The world's needs are not going to be magically less tomorrow or next year if we just push through. Change is exhausting. This is not an individual task. Some of you are thinking, Evan, do you know how hard it is for me in my life to find rest? Yes, I know. I have three kids at home. I know. This is not an individual challenge. This is a collective challenge. We must learn how to help each other rest, lift each other's burdens, even for a moment. So please, let us practice a future where we rest and recharge. Second, we must listen to the yes, to the joy, to the life-giving gleam in each other's eyes. I can tell this congregation knows how to do this. Being together with community, in connection, in joy, in play, is so needed. So as the world changes, we flex and adapt. Listen for that feeling that yes, this is right. Yes, this gives me life. Yes, this brings us joy. Yes, this is fun. Whether for you that's theater or art or dancing or games or organizing or cooking or eating together, listen for the yes. At times, you may really have to work against that ingrained Puritan work ethic. Work is supposed to feel hard, not fun. Remember, new skills and ideas are learned faster through play. Play changes our brains, builds resilience, discharges stress. If you come from a family or a community not steeped in the Puritan work ethic, know that one of the gifts that you can bring Unitarian Universalism is noticing when we fall in the Puritan work ethic hole and lower a ladder to help the rest of us out. Let's practice a future filled with joy, the play, the connection, the yes. This is right. Now, I'm tempted to end right here because rest and play are really what so many people need right now. But rest and play alone would be a spiritual avoidance of the hard parts of the present and practicing the future. So three more ways to practice. We must keep making space for grief and acknowledging the ghosts of the past. I know some of us, myself included, would like to be done with this part. Haven't we talked about the grief of the pandemic enough? But change brings loss and grief, and continued change will just keep bringing loss and grief. And while some feelings can be felt and let go of, much of our deep grief of how much change we are living through will stay with us. We each have some personal such ghosts, and we have collective ones too. If we ignore them, stuff the feelings inside, they will derail the present and future. Adrienne Marie Brown says, we are always dancing with our ghosts. Invite the ghosts into the dance. We can practice a future where we allow ourselves to feel, to grieve, and to know that the past is never past. It's always here with us. Fourth, we must be love. Be the kind of love that understands the real needs people have, the people here in this congregation and among your neighbors, the kind of love that welcomes people as they are, where we can show up without our act together, when we have children who refuse to change out of their pajamas and still have breakfast in their hair and won't sit still, where we know these are the days people need community the most. I know your congregation can do this. I've heard so many stories from you of how you were invited in. Your friend or your neighbor said, you might want to try my church. Keep doing that. Your community needs you. This invitation, though, to meet people's needs is not an invitation to work too hard. We can't fix all the needs. We can't solve the world's problems. We can each do our own small part, and this congregation can do your small part. And fifth, last, we must continue to be flexible and change. I know liminal is a way of life right now, even though we are tired of the word. What works this year may not work next year. There are moments right now we aren't even sure what working means or how to know what's working. We know the future of faith is not likely to be primarily Sunday mornings and religious education classrooms. And people will keep needing community, keep needing a place to make meaning of the world, keep needing to be together in hard times, keep needing to play, connect, to sort through their own beliefs and ethics. And I can't tell you how to get from here to there because none of us know where there is. We have experiments of day camps and dinner church and play groups and prayer groups and new experiences I haven't caught up with yet. And I want to name that this is a profoundly UU shift. Our own UU-raised youth and young adults have been telling us about the importance of evening and circle worship, immersive camps, and other ways of being in community for decades. Those who were young adults before me, there are some here, were saying so before I came of age, and we were saying it then, and I am old enough now to be wrestling with the need for bifocals. Now, I don't mean come up with a list of things to tell your board, your ministers, and your staff what they should try. Every one of these folks here with their stoles has the longest list of ideas ever from their congregation. Someone should. And they can't try or do all these things on their own. And they're also noticing and pondering and have ideas, ideas they can't try on their own either. Adrienne Marie Brown speaks of murmuration. When the flock of starlings whirls in the sky and turns without a single bird giving orders or even holding a committee meeting. This is an all of us in time of change. The ideas we offer must be ideas we are willing to help with and be willing to let go of if the time isn't right. Your ministers may offer you an idea that is not what you would have thought of, might even make you uneasy. This time calls us all to be flexible and try new things. We can always change again and again and again. If in each breath we are adapting to each other's experiments, moving together into new ideas, may our flexibility and change be like that flock of starlings. Here is what I know. We are practicing the future, and the way we are with each other now is the future we are planting. If we can be flexible and adaptive enough to meet our community's needs today, we are gaining the skills and abilities to be flexible and adaptive to meet tomorrow's needs and the next day's. We cannot plan the future. We can only practice the future. Learn to rest. Listen for the yes. Make room for grief. Be love. Be flexible and adaptive. And measure it all in love. The future is being decided. The future is being practiced. The future is being planted in this breath, and this breath, and this breath. So I breathe in, noticing the gift I too often take for granted, not knowing how many breaths I have left. I want to spend them being love.
The first church I ever served was the First Universalist Church in Auburn, Maine. I was contracted to be a one-year interim. I was coming in after a long-serving and beloved minister. She'd been there. She was fantastic. She transformed this congregation. And I was called to come in and do all the things that an interim minister does. I had my list of things and when you have a minister for a long time, you get a little sloppy. That minister gets a little sloppy. Don't worry, John's not here to hear any of this. Don't worry. But one of the things that you have to do is you got to, kick the tires. You got to make sure everyone understands that there are things that you should have been doing that you hadn't been doing. And one of the things is getting new leadership. And one of the people that we had that I was able to get very quickly was the collector. Now, I'm not sure you have a collector here, but that's the person who collects, and keeps track of all the pledges that go out, that come in each week, and then sends a statement out quarterly of how much money you've given. And as soon as that first quarterly statement went out, I got a phone call from a church member who said, It says, my statement says, I haven't given any money at all. I've been putting money in that plate every week. And I said, oh, okay, all right. I was new. I was a new minister. I was like, okay, let me see. Now, do you write a check? Remember those things? You write a check? And they went, oh, yeah. No, I don't write a check at all. No. I said, okay. I said, no, I put cash in. Oh, all right. So you've got one of those envelopes. You remember those envelopes, right? Whether you have your pre-printed number on there and you put that. No. I said, well, how, I mean, before I could even ask the question, the person said, I'm the swan. I said, you're the swan. Each week I take my $20 bill and I fold it like origami style into the shape of a swan. Johanna knew all about this. The previous minister knew all about this, knew what animal I was. This is the time for our collection. The money that we collect today is going towards the Living Tradition Fund. It provides money in scholarships for seminarians, people in seminary right now. It provides money for people after they've graduated and are serving our larger community to help pay off some of those student debts. And it also goes for emergency funds. So at this point, I'm going to ask you to take out all of your fancy folding money or your checkbooks, or whatever it is that you need to take that money out and put it in the plate. And I'm going to ask the ushers when they come by, make sure you also pass those plates to the ministers and the choir. Make sure that we all get a chance to give to this fund. The offering will now be given and joyfully received.
We could have just let that be the prayer. Yet we are people of the word. As we prepare to witness, affirm, and make sacred the promises pledged for this awakening season of ministry, let us pray for this minister and this church and all who will receive the gifts of this season here and beyond your walls. Ancient calm, be here among us so we might listen. Listen and learn from the wondrous and beautiful tapestry woven from those who have come before us, who have offered threads of wisdom and a deep and abiding faith. Let us listen at this milestone where past and present meet. For it is in your calm that we ask you to help us recall this tapestry of deep and abiding faith and how necessary, how needed, how desired it is. Even more so today, to equip us as we companion each other and those we have yet to meet in this time where divides are deep and the gaps between equity and freedom and peace just continue to widen. May we listen. Listen to the voices who depend upon that all-inclusive love to mind the gap and heal divides. We pray this awakening season of ministry grounded in that deep and abiding love that fosters beautiful stories and wondrous experiences of divine joy in this sacred work together. That as we rest in your calm, we hear the song that sings in your hearts. We pray for a love strong enough, grounded enough for honesty and humility when the road is muddy and rough. And we pray that the fiber and design of that collective tapestry is wide enough for the deepened expressions of forgiveness and compassion. Oh God, who we call love, mystery, holy, bless this minister. Bless this congregation and all who are part of our association. May we abide. May we abide within and between you. Remind all who serve of the love which holds us, all of us, and does not, will not let us go. This we pray today and all days. Amen.
You can come here.
So it's the time in the service right now for the actual act of installation. Really exciting. So no right is more precious to a free congregation than that of choosing its own minister. In our Unitarian Universalist tradition, the authority and privilege of calling ministers has always rested solely with the congregation. Likewise, each minister has the right to freely choose the congregation they serve. The relationship between minister and congregation then is a covenant of mutual trust and support, freely entered into in the service of our living tradition. Our act of installation today celebrates and solemnizes this covenant between the First Parish in Bedford and the Reverend Jamie Hinson-Rieger. Reverend Jamie, we have called you to be our senior minister, to join us in our commitments and concerns, to minister to us alike in times of joy and sorrow, to speak the truth in love as you understand it, and to lead us as best as you are able in the service of love and justice. Are you prepared to accept the invitation of this congregation to shared ministry?
I am.
Thank goodness. Thank you. Will the members of First Parish in Bedford please rise in body and spirit and join me in the words of installation, which are in the order of service. Reverend Jamie, we pledge to journey with you in the ways of truth, justice, love, and peace. We offer you a free pulpit. We offer our goodwill and support and cheerful encouragement. We offer the cooperation of our hearts in service of our shared values. Chief among these values are the inherent worth and dignity of each person, the interconnectedness and sacredness of all life, the freedom of each of us to seek the truth in love, and the responsibility of the community to work for a world in which all may thrive. We pledge to remember that the work of the church belongs to us all. Will you join us in this shared ministry?
With gratitude, with humility, and with joy, with so much joy, I accept the ministry to which you have called me. I promise to serve you and our Unitarian Universalist tradition to the best of my abilities. I promise to support you in cultivating a community of kindness and compassion, hope and courage, understanding and peace. And I promise we will have fun doing it. May we be a blessing to one another and to the world.
We, the members of First Parish in Bedford, do hereby install you, the Reverend Jamie Hinson-Rieger, as senior minister of our congregation. Let the people say amen.
Amen.
And welcome.
Well, as long as you are all risen in body or spirit, let's sing a hymn. How about Spirit of Life, number 123? We'll sing it two times.
So Jamie, it's the time and the service to present you with our gift of a stole. I know that you chose the design, but you haven't seen it yet. Okay, just so you know. So I would like to invite Maureen Ricicci to come up as chair of the search committee last year. I'd like you to come up to the chancel and to do the honors. So the excellent job that the committee did last year has resulted in your standing here in front of us today. Thank you to the committee and to all the parishioners who were involved in the process. We are so glad to have you with us, Jamie. Welcome. Woo.
I would be remiss not to give my thanks in this time to the amazing search committee and all of the incredible work they did that started this journey and brought us to this moment. And to all of you, thank you for the gift of this stole. It is beautiful, and I will wear it with great joy and pride and acceptance of the responsibility that comes with it. So thank you.
So John Gibbons, we're inviting you back up here. Welcome. You guys could just stand over here just for a minute. Okay. Thank you. Gosh, we're so lucky. This is a covenant between Reverend Jamie Hinson-Rieger, Senior Minister, and the Reverend John Gibbons, Minister Emeritus of First Parish in Bedford. We all recognize that after a lengthy and successful tenure as Parish Minister, John will remain in the consciousness of this congregation for many years to come. At the same time, we are entirely committed to do everything to make Jamie's ministry successful. With these goals understood, Jamie and John make the following covenant with each other.
As ministers and as Unitarian Universalists, Jamie and I both want what is best for our movement and for this First Parish in Bedford. The health of this congregation and the continuing advancement of our mission matter deeply to us. As colleagues, we also desire to be in right relationship with one another.
John, as a member of First Parish and as Minister Emeritus, you are always welcome to attend church events and worship services as any other member of our community. As you now serve as community minister with the Arlington Street Church in Boston and have other personal and ministerial commitments, there is no expectation of your attendance or involvement here at First Parish. At some time, John may participate in parish activities or return to our pulpit as a guest preacher, and again, there is no formal expectation. At any major institutional event in Bedford, John will be invited to take a ceremonial role with me. I am grateful to John for the good work he has done. I am grateful to you for the good work you have done. And proud of what this congregation accomplished during his tenure. I have the utmost respect for the wisdom, insight, and depth of knowledge that John has about the life of the congregation from his long term of service. With John, we both agree to be open to conversations about the ongoing health and development of the congregation. With John, we both pledge to honor the letter and spirit of the UU Ministers Association's Code of Conduct, which counsels mutual sensitivity, respect, and support between ministers particularly those who share an intimate connection to the same institution.
With regard to my participation in parish activities, I will offer my counsel such as it is on matters related to the ongoing life of the church to Jamie in private and only publicly or with congregants when invited by Jamie. I will not serve on committees or assume any leadership position in the church unless invited by Jamie to do so. In terms of social relationships with the members of First Parish, I will be sensitive to appropriate boundaries and to be clear that Jamie is this congregation's senior minister and he is my minister. I may sometimes attend services or other events, and when parishioners ask me to participate in life cycle events such as weddings and memorial services, as I am able, I may attend. When asked to officiate, I will generally decline, or I will defer to Jamie's request or judgment. Likewise, in all matters of pastoral care, I will refer and defer to Jamie. Everyone should know that these are not always clear or easy needles to thread. In every instance, our priority is the priority and the affirmation of Jamie's ministry and the health of this congregation. Jamie and I pledge to regard one another as respected colleagues.
In summary, Reverends Hinson-Rieger and Gibbons pledge their respect for each other and their foremost desire that this congregation should flourish as a religious community. John will honor the fact that Jamie is the senior minister of First Parish in Bedford and that Jamie will honor John's service as minister emeritus. Jamie and John will periodically review this covenant and inform the board as the need arises. As a shared ministry, both lay and professional, we will do all that we can to advance the mission of First Parish in Bedford and the liberating purposes and principles of Unitarian Universalism. Thank you both.
Jamie, thank you for inviting me to offer you the charge as the senior minister here at First Parish in Bedford. It's an honor. I'm Sarah Stewart. I'm the minister at First Unitarian Church in Worcester, and I have been working with Jamie for 2 years as his ministerial mentor. I always look forward to our conversations. I am impressed by your curiosity, your patience, and the love for the people you serve. The people you serve. When we talk about Unitarian Universalist ministry, we don't use the ordinary language of employment. The settled minister is called, not hired. They are settled, not tenured or vested or made partner. They're installed, my brother said, like a bit of software. And they serve, they don't work. Perhaps churches and clergy like to protect the ministry, as though if we used the same words as we do for ordinary work, we might get our robes dirty. Yet, it is work, and ministry has all the dignity of work, including work that gets dirt underneath your fingernails. There is work in this world that needs to be done. The spiritual work of the First Parish in Bedford matters. Both the transformation that happens in the hearts and minds of children and adults here in the congregation, and the human flourishing that you help make possible in the world. I hope you all will do work together that you can feel proud of. And I hope you will remember who it is that you work for. In any job, the new employee should know for whom they work. Here, the congregation has called you, and you'll report regularly to the parish board, and a wise minister takes their counsel to heart. But they're not your boss, despite the occasional member who thinks they should be. And you're not theirs, despite all the unasked for authority people can try to vest in the minister. No, it is so much better than that. You and they, all the lay leaders, Reverend Annie, your colleagues on staff, the membership of the parish, the youth, and the children, you all work for the same boss, the spirit that calls you and sends you to do the work that needs doing in this world. There will be times in this ministry, Jamie, when you are tempted to do it all. There will be nights you think you have to stay late, even though you have promised your family that you would be home. There will be vacations when you think you'll be a bad minister if you don't keep up with your email. Almost every week, you'll need to write a sermon. And there will be times it takes all of your will to sit alone at your table to listen to the still small voice instead of checking another task off your to-do list. There will be moments when you think that the only way something can be done right is if you do it. In every one of those moments, I want you to remember that everyone here is called to do the work of the holy. They are all called to the work of the church. They are working, you are working on your relationship to the holy, and they hope that this church will help them do it. God did not call only you to this sacred work. The call goes out to every person here, and the response is loudest and strongest when everyone has the chance to answer. Not only do you and you all work for the holiness that grounds this church's deepest values, that spirit moves in the world even when you rest. You can't do it all, Jamie. Even the whole church working together all the time can't do it all. Something greater holds you and carries you through the night. When you've done your good work, when the day is over, when you have done everything you can and things are still not perfect, remember your faith. The wise leader says at the end of the day, "It's your church, God. I'm going home." This is a church known for its joy and its living spirit. You have told me, Jamie, that there is a culture here that meets people where they are and says yes to their passion for mission and ministry. This installation is a big yes to this new ministry shared between you and them. I hope that spirit continues, with all of you empowering each other to seek your own pathway in the midst of the sacred, supporting each other in doing the holy work that you have been called to do. It's honest work, sometimes transcendent, more often mundane, occasionally dirty, or even dangerous. It's good work, worth doing together, worth doing with heart, so that when you look back at the ways you have served the holy, the love you've grown, the justice you've enabled, all on behalf of the spirit that knows you and calls you, you'll know you did the best work you could by
by doing it together. Blessings on your new shared ministry.
I am so honored to be here with you today to give this charge to the congregation as part of such an auspicious and historic event. It's with two legacies in mind, those of this church and the Unitarian Universalist Association, and their trajectories, that I challenge and charge you, the members and friends of this congregation, with a trinity of responsibilities. My first charge is really quite simple, but it's hard to do. Remember that Jamie, your minister, is human, is a human being first and foremost. Like all of us, he has his own set of strengths, challenges, and needs. Let him be a real person, a husband, a father, someone who requires time to recharge. Supporting Jamie in balancing his personal life with his responsibilities as a minister will allow him to lead in a way that is genuine and sustainable. I loved witnessing the covenant between senior minister and minister emeritus just now. You all have worked so hard as a congregation to recognize your own expectations and biases about ministry, especially those rooted in the past. You know Jamie is not here to replicate the ministry of his predecessors or to fulfill an idealized vision of a perfect minister. Just as we expect Jamie to lead from the places of truth and understanding as he knows them, we must release him from the burden of comparison as often as we humanly can. Ask good questions of Jamie and join him in going deeper here and now. Charge number two, good communication is key. When I was a child, my family had a habit of putting chicken bones from dinner into an old frozen orange juice can. You know those, like, you dump, add three other bits of water, and stir? So we used those a lot. And we would put our chicken bones in there and then take the can and put it in the freezer so that we didn't have a smelly garbage all week. Then on trash day, we would toss the frozen can of bones out with the garbage. But one time we ran out of frozen orange juice cans. And my dad found an old cereal box, and he thought that it would work just as well. So he filled it with the scraps of our chicken dinner, and he put it in the freezer. Later, my mom found a random cereal box in the freezer, and she thought she must have had a spacey moment and moved the box to its proper shelf in the pantry. For weeks, our walk-through pantry area was putrid with a terrible stench, and it only got worse and worse. We searched high and low to no avail. We cleaned the microwave. We removed a panel from the wall to find this suspected dead mouse. And we just got more and more frustrated and overwhelmed by the grossness. We weren't a family who ate out in restaurants. So once during this time, we even went out for pizza together as a family. It was so special, but it was just because it was just so bad at home. And at long last, someone decided to have a bowl of Raisin Bran for breakfast. Hosanna in the highest, save me. This was the grossest experience of my childhood. what a lot of trouble over what was basically a communication issue. My charge to you is this. If you ever have something that is unpleasant or that just needs to be dealt with, don't let it fester. If no one can locate the root cause, or if there is a negative vibe that is only just gonna spread and get worse, do not contaminate your spiritual house. Speak directly to one another, or put an issue on the table for a group to solve together. Support those that you have empowered to lead. This means your board members that you've elected, and it definitely means both of your settled and now called ministers. Be a positive contributor when you can. Don't be a quiet stinker. All right, my last charge is to keep being bold and to do it in the context of having fun together. You have long been thought leaders within the wider context of Unitarian Universalism. Continue to be at the forefront of collective liberation. Chain yourself to a tree, if that means saving it. Become a sanctuary for an immigrant for 3 years. Sue the town over solar panels. Send youth delegates to the UN. Swivel heads every time they drive by for any banner you hang out. Play with the children in the families that our government doesn't want to house. Lie down in pipelines. Partner with churches in Transylvania. Propose actions of immediate witness at General Assembly. Go for net zero emissions, no contamination on our stinky spiritual house's behalf. Send books to prisoners, fight capitalism and greed in any way that you can. Ground your reasons for action from the core of our shared theology. This congregation holds a respected role within the town of Bedford and in surrounding communities. It's been said over and again that First Parish in Bedford is a spiritual hub with a civic circumference. But you may not realize just how much our broader Unitarian Universalist movement needs congregations to serve as beacons of insight with clarity of mission, and with congregants who show up in person to do what needs to be done. Thought leadership and boots on the ground ministry are tasks no minister can tackle alone, and it would be a mistake to try. So as a congregation, stay humble yet bold. Pool your ideas. Follow the lead of those in marginalized communities and collaborate in taking risks together on behalf of something good for all. I charge you to continue being the church the world needs. Last of all, keep playfulness alive. Have some serious fun in the spirit of the haunted house, which those of us who go to this thing. No, the entire church becomes a haunted house, and it's also a giant fundraiser around here, and every age person is involved, and people quit their day jobs to just come in and do this amazing thing. So be especially forgiving of experiments gone awry. Just go for it, because it's real, it's alive, and it's fun in the here and now, and it connects us all. Adventure together. Speak your truth in love. Let go of perfectionism. Laugh early and often. Be here now. All hands on deck. This ship is leaving the harbor. Bon voyage. And our closing hymn is "We Shall Be Known." The words are in your order of service, and I invite you to rise in body or in spirit.
Not quite yet. Don't rise yet.
Well, Brad hasn't spoken, so here we go.
So many of you may know this hymn already, or this song by Ma Muse. If you do, I hope you will sing the entire thing with us. Choir and I are going to lead it, but for those of you who do not yet know it, and to give you the opportunity to get a jump on it, I am just, before we rise, I'm just going to teach you what is numbered part two in the order of service. And it's fun. It starts with a call to action, and it will get our energy up for the fellowship that is to follow. I'm going to sing, you sing back to me. And I will sort of do a little bit of this lovely movable solfege that I will do inaccurately, but significantly, I hope. It is time now. It is time now. One more time. It is time now. Okay, that comes up a lot, so it will help you. The first line of part two, I'll sing it, you sing it back. It is time now. It is time now that we thrive. It is time now. It is time now that we thrive. Second line, I'll sing it, you sing it back. It is time to, I'm sorry, it is time we lead ourselves into the well. It is time we lead ourselves into the well. One more time. It is time we lead ourselves into the well. Good. Two lines, first two lines of part two. Sing it with me. It is time now. It is time now that we thrive. It is time we lead ourselves into the well. Okay, next line. I'll sing it, you sing it back. It is time now. And what a time to be alive. It is time now, and what a time to be alive. One more time, and that's a little rundown. And what a time, okay. It is time now, and what a time to be alive. And now the last two lines. I'll sing them both, you sing them back. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead in love. Very good. Okay, we're going to sing the whole thing through twice. Pick it up as you go. When you hear the drum begin, that means we're going to get started, and we'll start with part one and go through the whole thing. We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle round to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change alive from deep within the earth. Part two. Great.
right turning, we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead in love.
We'll do it all again. If you feel like it, sing harmony.
We shall be known by the ones who really keep, by the ones who circle round to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change alive from deep within the earth.
Friends, thank you all. I am so grateful for the blessing of this installation service. I am grateful to be here at First Parish, grateful for this shared ministry that we are embarking on together. And if there is just one thing that I hope you hear and remember from this amazing service today, it is this: there are snacks. There is so much food, you would not even believe it. Please join us after the postlude, which is in your insert, for so many wonderful refreshments that are waiting for you in the common room, out that away, and I will be there as well to say hello. So now, with our spirits lifted up, with our minds and hearts full, grateful for this community, grateful for our living tradition, grateful for connection and compassion and mystery and wonder, grateful above all for the healing and transformative power of love, which we all participate in and we all return to. Let us go from here and be a blessing to one another and to our world. Blessed be and amen. Go in peace.